Today on Typical Books, it is Heads Will Roll by Josh Winning. It's a very shiny book, so I might not hold it up a whole bunch, but yeah, I really enjoyed this. And as you recall, I chose it mostly because of the cover. So this is a 2024 release from GP Putnam Sons, Penguin House, actually, Penguin Random House. The cover design by Vi-An Nguyen, and the fonts involved in this book are probably Jansen, Ortega, different letter forms. These aren't actually fonts that are on the cover. It's a design by the designer. So why I chose this book? I chose this book partially because of the cover. It was absolutely irresistible. Now, of course, this was part of the patrons poll where there were other books it was running against, but the cover and the description together were why it ended up on that poll in the first place. And I'm certain that the description is the biggest reason that it won the votes on that poll. Everyone can't be as into just cover art as I am, but well, maybe some people are. There is a reason the saying don't judge a book by its cover is there. It's because we often do. So it's that 1-2 punch, the same thing that gets you in the bookstore. So when you're standing in the aisle and you see a cover of any genre that calls to you, and then you turn it over and you read the back copy, that's the second reason that this book spoke to me, and why I would have eventually read it anyway, I'm sure, depending on the time, because of the cancellation of somebody or the doing or saying of something on social media that leads to cancellation. Now, on a good day, I dislike social media. On a bad day, I'm afraid of social media. So this speaks to me, as it does many people, not that we're all saying terrible things and getting canceled. So we've all followed people on social media who have gotten canceled, I'm sure, or been on the sidelines of people who we've never followed or never would follow that are being canceled. And I think it specifically speaks to fans of horror or fantasy fiction, those who may have read Harry Potter books. Then they go on Twitter the last couple years and just watch in awe and amazement or shock and maybe revulsion or fear. So I think that that topic really speaks to us. So there's also, on top of that, the John Ronson book, So You've Been Publicly Shamed. I've not read that book, but I've listened to him speak about it and I've watched videos about it and I've seen interviews with him on that topic. And this is a book that came out before cancel culture was really on the tips of our tongues. And somebody made a tweet, got on an airplane, and by the time that they hit the ground, they had been fired, were reviled worldwide. Their phone had completely blown up, if you recall the story. This happens to Willow in this book over a tweet that they didn't really initially know that it was going to be so terrible. And we're not told what she said. We're not told what the tweet is till very far later in the book. And I like that because you're constantly being like, well, what did she say, right? Same thing, if you hear that someone's canceled online or everyone reviles them, you want to know why. You want to look for that root tweet that caused it in a way. And I think that's just sort of human nature to make your own decision. We want to make our own decision about Willow early on in this book. So her fans hate her. People in her family probably doubt her, and she has lost her job. Her agent has no idea what to do, so sends her to Camp Castaway, and she needs it, frankly. From the back cover, Willow's worst nightmare was being canceled. And I like that line because it kind of alludes to like her being on a TV show or being canceled in this nature. But the shadows in the woods of Camp Castaway might destroy more than her reputation. After sitcom star Willow tweets herself into infamy and stumbles blind drunk into a swimming pool, her agent ships her off to Camp Castaway. Nestled deep in upstate New York, Camp Castaway is a summer camp for adults who are desperate to leave their mistakes behind. No real names, no phones, no way to call for help. Willow's fellow campers seem okay. Her own favorite actress is here making a s'more. And did that jaded writer, Danny, just wink at her? But the peaceful vibe is shattered when one of the campers vanishes and Willow finds a mutilated doll in her room with a threatening message rolled up inside its mouth. Terror grips the group and campers begin to lose their heads, literally. And disturbing past deeds come to light. Is Willow about to get canceled all over again and this time for good? It's kind of campy, no pun intended, that description. Now, of course, this is a horror story. There's a giant axe dripping blood on the cover, and the last line is that she's going to get canceled this time for good. Of course, speaks to us as far as camp slashers go. What happens in a slasher film that is taking place at a camp? Well, the counselors get killed, for one thing. Half of the people there get killed. And then we have a final girl who, the shining example of this is Willow, of course. They're probably going to be chased around by an axe-wielding maniac. And I will say that this book does deliver on all those fronts. I mean, if it didn't, then people would probably be crying foul. And I've heard good reviews of this book so far. I don't believe it's a spoiler to say that the main girl, Willow, who gets mentioned on the back of the book, gets chased around by an axe-wielding maniac. I mean, yes, she is in the most basic sense. The plot is that Willow goes to camp and has to evade getting murdered. It's evident from the back cover and the front cover even. The two things that made me buy this book and made me so interested in it. But the other side of the coin is always going to be, let's find out who's doing the murdering. And the biggest plot point that throws enough red herrings at us to keep it more of a mystery or a murder mystery as opposed to a thriller, that I do enjoy about this book, is that it maintains a horror pace and a horror tone mingled with the mystery. Now, the setting of Camp Castaway may be very enticing to some. If you're a fan of camp slashers and you've seen those pine needle pathways from cabin to cabin stretching off into the shady forest, you may be enticed to go to Camp Castaway yourself. I know I was. And if you spend too much time on screens and your eyes are aching and your thumbs are sore and your neck is crooked, then you may want to attend Camp Castaway, because again, I know I did. If you just have a love for that sort of glamping level of being out in nature and not wanting to ruck a tent or a sleeping bag around for a week, then you just wanted like an easy peasy comfy bed and a roof and meals provided for you probably, and a little bit of a campfire song at night with a nice clean campfire ring, a relaxing outdoorsy experience, then you may want to attend Camp Castaway. The setting, of course, is a summer camp, and it's a very typical summer camp. I used to work a bit at a YMCA camp and a different camp, very similar. I've attended camp at Eagle Lake here in Ontario, and those camp areas run by family members, friends, and they manage a set of cabins like this. I've been to that sort of camp as well as a kid, visiting family. So you may have seen this, of course, in Friday the 13th, and it's exactly what it is. A lot of these places are situated in pine forest because there's less bugs maybe, and it's easier to build. They have a softer undergrowth, and there's all sorts of reasons that it would be far more lovely under these giant pine trees. And that's the setting that I can get that smell and that gorgeous pine scent in the air in my memories comes through on these pages. Those early crisp mornings when you get out of your semi-comfortable cabin to go and follow the scent of coffee wafting through the paths, you get that feeling in this book. Now, setting is something to be steeped in. There is good character building as well, but we are introduced to the camp as we're introduced to Willow because she's being driven there in that very first chapter. We get full-on camp cabins, shower area, down the trails into the forest, little larger area where there's the house that's usually attached to these sorts of camps. The only thing that was missing was a central lodge, but that is taken over by a stone circle outside that they spend a lot of time around. So this doesn't have that base feeling. There's like a home base of the lodge in Sleepaway Camp or Friday the 13th. That I felt was kind of missing. Or in a more contemporary sense, if you played the Supermassive video games like The Quarry or Until Dawn. Now, Until Dawn, it isn't a lodge of a camping place. It's like a big mansion-style cottage that everyone was staying in. But The Quarry does have a large lodge that you get to know quite well. And I felt that that was missing as an anchor in the story, not only in the setting, but as a character in itself, because this camp is just too sprawling for you to feel very close to it. So needless to say, I didn't feel very attached to the Stone Circle campfire either. Feeling attached to the characters is something entirely different. I'm not usually susceptible to that sort of thing, but Willow is a main character, which I've likened to an Ally McBeal, a show I didn't really watch. I don't watch a lot of television, so it was hard for me, in a way, to envision what this person was like outside of a caricature of a female TV star, because it's not someone that I usually idolize either. So I haven't watched television for a very long time, so Hannah Montana, iCarly, Ally McBeal, that sort of thing. I have nowhere else to really go with this. However, she is an internet personality as well, like most stars are, or even writers. And that's something I think we can all sort of relate to. I think it's a brilliant move on Josh Winning's part to sort of give her two lives. She has her real life of her own in her mind and her heart, which we get to know, and that persona, which we also get to understand. She's also in the closet, and we learn this quite quickly in the story, although it's hinted at first that she's bisexual and has not been living as such for quite some time. I really like the LGBTQ slant in this because it really works with the plot as far as having secrets or coming to terms with knowing yourself. And I don't want to give anything else away, of course, plot-wise, but later on in this book, this does develop as a plot construct and what it does to decision-making for the main character and for other characters around them. They have conversations about these things with others. So as a reader, we come to understand Willow's motivations in a broader context. So Danny, Misty, and Kate are the lady campers alongside Juniper, who is the star talked about in the description. Now, Ty and Buck and Kurt make up the male campers alongside Chef Jeff, who I kind of like. He works for the camp, as well as Ty, who also works for the camp. But blends a lot more often with the campers, so he just sort of feels like a camper. And I've encountered camp counselors in my life that sort of feels like that. You forget that they are an authority figure. In many ways, he's sort of a camp counselor, but these are all adults, right? So would there be such a thing? BB is the owner of the camp. And I will say I did mix up some of the male campers. The female campers from time to time, not as much. They're all pretty separate. And not because they lack character development either, but they're just not front and center enough. And near the end, when one of them is gone, I mixed him up with another guy and I wondered why they were back. So, I mean, that's really my own fault. Maybe not reading as closely as I could have in certain parts, but they just weren't really very separate in my mind. I do appreciate a lot of the back and forth between Willow and Danny, though. She is a very interesting character in her own right, and the two of them having conversations let us get to know them, and I enjoy that quite a lot. Their characters just really blend well too, I think. And this is one of those books that is a horror book for horror fans, where the main character talks about horror movies a lot. Not so much books, but in a way it's sort of enchanting because we get the idea that she was never allowed to like horror movies, and as a woman you may have experienced that, or as somebody in a hyper-reserved household, you may have experienced that. It's refreshing for them to be able to use horror movie references freely in the wild, and you feel that relief. I think it's part of why the main character skewed younger to me as well. Their horror movie references are kind of all over the place, and it's hard to pinpoint what kind of horror fan they are. And without like sounding like a gatekeeping of horror fan, it just tended to skew kind of younger with their tastes and their opinions, kind of hipsterish a little bit. There's a little bit of horror philosophy that is well developed, get peppered in amongst this book, which I really do enjoy. And that sort of being a meta narrative on horror fandom, even to a small degree, like this one. So it does have some sort of fan service in the way of what horror heroes would do and what a horror movie would be like if they were in one. Wink, wink. There's a little bit of that. So I like this because the entire book is a huge fan service to camp slashers, right? Luckily, all the characters do fit into the story properly because there's nothing worse than looking at a slasher story that has a gang of teens and you kind of wonder why they're even friends or how they would mingle together because they have such diverse representations, not in race or culture or economic status necessarily, but subculture and age and disposition. They're all about the same sort of economic class. They're all sort of about the same age, and they all sort of have the same temperament. And so you can imagine all these people coming to this camp or being canceled. They all spend equal amount of time online, I think, too. It's not all canceled people there, though. People that just need a break, maybe. There's people that are a little bit on the run. There's people who just want to be without screens or technology because it's a locked cell phone camp. Neatly solving the problem that a lot of novelists have or movie writers have in this day and age of how to treat cell phones because they can be that deus ex machina. And this neatly avoids all of that. Their phones are locked up for the duration of this story. And the phones being locked up becomes a little bit of a plot point later on because people are yearning for their phones or extolling the virtues of having given up their phone. And even later on in the story, when a phone could be super useful, that gets very interesting. There are other characters in among this that are off screen, like Willow's family and her agent and friends and followers of her, and other people that are peppered in amongst the story of little or great importance. Certainly not going to spoil any of the story here because it is an engaging read. Now, while my major criticism of this is that everyone sort of skews younger, I just have a bit of an aversion to YA in an adult horror wrapper. The Library of Congress classification for this book is gothic fiction / thriller fiction, which is normal. Using gothic fiction as a term for horror is really popular. So reading that and the back cover and looking at the cover, I did expect it to be a little more brutal and maybe a little less juvenile. Maybe I'm just getting a little older and there isn't as much of a focus on writing for my age range, and the target of horror seems to be younger and younger each year, or coming closer to the YA. So they're going to be blending with a lot of gray area there. And I think that's sort of where this is edging into. They read like a lot younger, like under 18, even though they're supposed to be 18 to 30, somewhere in there, these people. A good part of the story is actually suitable for a younger audience, so I have no trouble recommending this book to people who are 13 or 14 and up. They would enjoy it very much. Or, of course, if you just enjoy lighter fare in horror and don't want something extremely terrifying or gory, then this would be a really good book to choose. It has some genuinely creepy moments. It has wonderful summer camp atmosphere. I think every time I go to read as a camp slasher, I go back to Friday the 13th or Sleepaway Camp as far as film goes. And books, you know, I really only have Con Season by Adam Caesar to equate it to. So if you know of any other on the campground, in the cabins, pine needle strewn pathway camp slashers that live up to those examples, definitely let me know. I've also likened it to and mentioned the Supermassive games like The Quarry. The Quarry is a beautiful camp slasher. So even if you don't play video games, you would really enjoy that. If you have played The Quarry, then you would definitely enjoy Heads Will Roll by Josh Winning. So if you have read it, let me know in the comments below. I'm very interested. Or of course, if I've enticed you to pick it up, let me know what you think of it when you're done. Thank you so much for watching, and have an ooky spooky day.